listening library proudly presents Charlotte's Web by E.B. White. Narrated by Meryl Streep with a full cast. With an appreciation written and read by Melissa Sweet.
This is Melissa Sweet, the author and illustrator of Some Writer, The Story of E.B. White, and the cover illustrator of this full cast edition of Charlotte's Web. I fell in love with Charlotte's Web when I began researching for a biography of E.B. White. I'm sure I had read this book as a child, but I only recalled the famous first line, "Where's Papa going with that axe?" In preparing to write Some Writer and learning as much as possible about E.B. White, I read everything he wrote. There were so many questions to answer. Where did he come up with the ideas for his stories? Was the story of Charlotte's Web from his life, or his imagination, or both? When I wasn't reading, I was listening to the original author-narrated audio versions of White's three children's books, especially the Charlotte's Web audiobook, over and over again. Even after I knew Charlotte's Web well, I looked forward to the conversations between the animals, the descriptions of the barnyard and landscape, and hearing my favorite passages come around again. And though I knew what would happen at every turn, each time I heard the ending, I thought my heart would break. E.B. White was born Elwin Brooks White in 1899 in Mount Vernon, New York. He was the youngest of six children, growing up in a big sprawling house with a barn. He loved tending animals, dogs, ducks, chickens, pigeons, and pollywogs, and spending summers in Maine. As a boy, he was busy writing poems, stories, and letters to his brothers and sisters. Long after he became a writer, signing his work E.B. White, he and his wife bought a farm in Maine. He later wrote, "When I got a place in the country, I was quite sure animals would appear, and they did." Soon, White introduced sheep, geese, chickens, and a pig to the barn. He said the rat and spider moved in on their own. As on many farms, the White family raised animals for food. One day, the pig did not appear for supper. White knew that if a pig, or any animal, refused to eat a meal, something was wrong. Indeed, the pig was sick. White called a vet and gave the pig medicine, but a few days later, the pig died. The death was part of life on a farm, and White had done all he could to save the pig. It affected him deeply to see the pig suffer. After burying the pig, he vowed to find a way to save another pig's life. Not long after, he was doing chores and saw a spider spinning an egg sack in the doorway of his barn. He put the egg sack in a box with holes in it, and within weeks watched as hundreds of baby spiders were born. Then one day, as White was bringing a pail of slops out to the barn, he had an idea. He wanted to write a story about animals, and he needed to find a way to save a pig's life. Could a spider save a pig's life? He asked his editor, "Has a spider ever been a main character in a children's book?" "Not that she knew of," she said. "Not since Miss Muffet." White wrote, "I conceived the idea for the story, and by that time I was well acquainted with the principal characters." Before attempting the book, however, he spent a year studying spiders. "In this," he said, "I found the key to the story. I watched Charlotte at work, here on my place, and I also read books about the life of spiders to inform myself about their habits, their capabilities, their temperament." He learned Charlotte's scientific name was Urania cavatica, a common gray barn spider found all over New England. For the next 2 years, he wrote at least seven drafts of Charlotte's Web, but he wasn't satisfied. He set the story aside for another year to let it ripen, he said. He then rewrote it, introducing Fern and other characters. It was a year well spent. White once said, "I would rather wait a year than publish a bad children's book, as I have too much respect for children." After the book was published, writer Eudora Welty described the story. "What the book is about is friendship on earth, affection and protection, adventure and miracle, life and death, trust and treachery, pleasure and pain, and the passing of time. What it all proves is that human beings must always be on the lookout for the presence of wonder. As a piece of work, it is just about perfect. White once said, "I am a word man, and I attach the very highest importance to words." He chose his words carefully, not just for their meaning, but for their sound. That may be one reason why Charlotte's Web is so memorable. Listening to White's writing is akin to listening to a piece of music that moves us. We hear something new each time. White wrote that Charlotte's Web was a hymn to the barn. As Charlotte says to Wilbur, "The leaves will shake from the trees and fall. Christmas will come, then the snows of winter. You will live to enjoy the beauty of the frozen world. Winter will pass, the days will lengthen, the ice will melt in the pasture pond. The song sparrow will return and sing, the frogs will awake, the warm wind will blow again. All these sights and sounds and smells will be yours to enjoy, Wilbur, this lovely world, these precious days." Indeed, this is the gift of Charlotte's Web, that we can count on the cycle of life and that this astonishing world is ours to love. This new recording features Academy Award-winning actress Meryl Streep, the first person to headline the Charlotte's Web audiobook narration since E.B. White stepped into the recording studio 50 years ago in 1970. White created a voice for each character, but for this edition, we've used more than 30 narrators to depict the farm animals and humans of Charlotte's Web. I based the art for this audiobook cover on White's farm on the coast of Maine. The scene illustrates the quintessential moment when Wilbur first meets Charlotte, the beginning of their friendship. White was once asked what he was trying to say in his books. He wrote, "All that I hope to say in books, all that I ever hope to say, is that I love the world. It's all there if you dig around." Happy listening.
Charlotte's Web. Chapter 1. Before Breakfast.
"Where's Papa going with that axe?"
said Fern to her mother as they were setting the table for breakfast.
"Out to the hog house,"
replied Mrs. Arable.
"Some pigs were born last night."
"I don't see why he needs an axe,"
continued Fern, who was only 8.
"Well,"
said her mother,
"one of the pigs is a runt. It's very small and weak, and it will never amount to anything. So your father has decided to do away with it."
"Do away with it?"
shrieked Fern.
"You mean kill it? Just because it's smaller than the others?"
Mrs. Arable put a pitcher of cream on the table.
"Don't yell, Fern,"
she said.
"Your father is right. The pig would probably die anyway."
Fern pushed a chair out of the way and ran outdoors. The grass was wet, and the earth smelled of springtime. Fern's sneakers were sopping by the time she caught up with her father.
"Please don't kill it,"
she sobbed.
"It's unfair."
Mr. Arable stopped walking.
"Fern,"
he said gently,
"you will have to learn to control yourself."
"Control myself?"
yelled Fern.
"This is a matter of life and death, and you talk about controlling myself."
Tears ran down her cheeks, and she took hold of the axe and tried to pull it out of her father's hand.
"Fern,"
said Mr. Arable,
"I know more about raising a litter of pigs than you do. A weakling makes trouble. Now run along."
"But it's unfair,"
cried Fern.
"The pig couldn't help being born small, could it? If I had been very small at birth, would you have killed me?"
Mr. Arable smiled.
"Certainly not,"
he said, looking down at his daughter with love.
"But this is different. A little girl is one thing. A little runty pig is another."
"I see no difference,"
replied Fern, still hanging on to the axe.
"This is the most terrible case of injustice I ever heard of."
A queer look came over John Arable's face. He seemed almost ready to cry himself.
All right,
he said.
You go back to the house, and I will bring the runt when I come in. I'll let you start it on a bottle, like a baby. Then you'll see what trouble a pig can be.
When Mr. Arable returned to the house half an hour later, he carried a carton under his arm. Fern was upstairs changing her sneakers. The kitchen table was set for breakfast, and the room smelled of coffee, bacon, damp plaster, and wood smoke from the stove.
Put it on her chair,
said Mrs. Arable. Mr. Arable set the carton down at Fern's place. Then he walked to the sink and washed his hands and dried them on the roller towel. Fern came slowly down the stairs. Her eyes were red from crying. As she approached her chair, the carton wobbled, and there was a scratching noise. Fern looked at her father. Then she lifted the lid of the carton. There, inside, looking up at her, was the newborn pig. It was a white one. The morning light shone through its ears, turning them pink.
He's yours,
said Mr. Arable.
Saved from an untimely death. And may the good Lord forgive me for this foolishness.
Fern couldn't take her eyes off the tiny pig.
Oh,
she whispered.
Oh, look at him. He's absolutely perfect.
She closed the carton carefully. First, she kissed her father. Then she kissed her mother. Then she opened the lid again, lifted the pig out, and held it against her cheek. At this moment, her brother Avery came into the room. Avery was 10. He was heavily armed, an air rifle in one hand, a wooden dagger in the other.
What's that?
He demanded.
What's Fern got?
She's got a guest for breakfast,
said Mrs. Arable.
Wash your hands and face, Avery.
Let's see it,
said Avery, setting his gun down.
You call that miserable thing a pig? That's a fine specimen of a pig. It's no bigger than a white rat.
Wash up and eat your breakfast, Avery,
said his mother.
The school bus will be along in half an hour.
Can I have a pig too, Pop?
Asked Avery.
No, I only distribute pigs to early risers,
said Mr. Arable.
Fern was up at daylight trying to rid the world of injustice. As a result, she now has a pig. A small one, to be sure, but nevertheless, a pig. It just shows what can happen if a person gets out of bed promptly. Let's eat.
But Fern couldn't eat until her pig had had a drink of milk. Mrs. Arable found a baby's nursing bottle and a rubber nipple. She poured warm milk into the bottle, fitted the nipple over the top, and handed it to Fern.
Give him his breakfast,
she said. A minute later, Fern was seated on the floor in the corner of the kitchen with her infant between her knees, teaching it to suck from the bottle. The pig, although tiny, had a good appetite and caught on quickly. The school bus honked from the road.
Run!
Commanded Mrs. Arable, taking the pig from Fern and slipping a donut into her hand. Avery grabbed his gun and another donut. The children ran out to the road and climbed into the bus. Fern took no notice of the others in the bus. She just sat and stared out of the window, thinking what a blissful world it was. And how lucky she was to have entire charge of a pig. By the time the bus reached school, Fern had named her pet, selecting the most beautiful name she could think of.
Its name is Wilbur,
she whispered to herself. She was still thinking about the pig when the teacher said,
Fern, what is the capital of Pennsylvania?
Wilbur,
replied Fern dreamily. The pupils giggled. Fern blushed. Chapter 2. Wilbur. Fern loved Wilbur more than anything. She loved to stroke him, to feed him, to put him to bed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.